Hey guys, welcome to episode number 262. Today is Monday, so it's update Monday, and I thought I would give you guys an update. I've been kind of under the weather with a cold lately, so I haven't been making videos, and I have been busy with work, but I think I'm pretty much back to my regular routine, making several videos per week, hopefully, cross your fingers, and this is going to kick off those videos. So I just fed some summer squash here to the 300-gallon stock tank. You will notice that I do have the terrapins in here and plenty of the endlers in here. I also have some angelfish, which are hiding at the moment, but I do have a common Placo in here, and that's what the summer squash is for the Placo. He basically only comes out at night, so I doubt we will see him today. But every time I turn the lights on in the morning, I do see him, and he likes to mow down on some algae tablets and some summer squash, and I'm sure he eats the turtle food that makes its way to the bottom of the tank as well. So just showing you that real quick. I do have quite a few updates here in the fish room to show you. First off, we do have the lids, which I have constructed for all four of the tanks that I have on this bottom rack, which is actually helping quite a bit with the evaporation. You can see the amount of water that's on the surface of these lids. Polycarbonate lids, I made a video of how to construct those. They're virtually indestructible, super cheap, and pretty much the best option that you can possibly have for your lids. As you'll see down here, we have a bristlenose Placo, and he's mowing down on that same summer squash. They love that stuff. I'll throw in a few pieces of squash in every tank and feed those every day or two. We do have a marbled crayfish here, and I don't know if it's going to come in that well on camera, but as you can see, he still has a blue hue to him, or her, I should say, and that's pretty unusual. At first I thought it was something that I was feeding to it that was making it blue, but I've been feeding it the same stuff that I fed all of the other crayfish, and he's still showing signs of blue, which is very odd. So I'm wondering if this is just a random mutation, and if this marbled crayfish really is exhibiting a blue pattern here, and if that's something that will be passed on. I don't believe it's carrying eggs at the moment. It is not, but I have it here in the tank all by itself. There are no other crayfish in this tank that I'm aware of, so when that thing makes babies, we'll find out if I get more of the same or not. Moving over here, we do have the two crayfish tanks. I've been considering converting these into angelfish tanks so that I can show you guys the angelfish that I have that are currently in the stock tank. I haven't done that yet. It's just because I have such an influx of crayfish here. You can see we've got more summer squash and the little guys mowing down on it. But I have basically too many marbled crayfish at the moment. And so I just have two tanks full of those. Not really sure what to do with it. They're not really worth shipping or selling at the moment, but they're just kind of hanging out. If I go to any aquarium auctions, I might auction some of them off. Again, as I've said previously, I might feed some to my turtles. But for right now, they're just chilling out. You know, I'm not really looking to make any big changes or expansions to this system at the moment. I'm just trying to kind of kick the tires on the filtration before I add any more fish to this system. And this is kind of where it all starts. I do have the heaters in here, as you've seen before. One addition that I've made is I've put like a 2-gallon bucket here
as like a temporary swirl filter slash pre-filter, and it has a bunch of holes along the top side, as you can see there, and that's letting water out. But what I'm hoping is happening, it's not really happening that well yet, is the water is going to kind of circulate in here, and hopefully the heavy debris settles to the bottom, and then the rest of the water will exit out those holes in the top. I have to refine this a little bit. I just kind of threw it in there real fast, and it's not really exactly what I want at the moment, but the idea is to have a pre-filter here. Actually, we have the pre-filter sponges here, so that's kind of the first line of defense, so most of the heavy debris will stay in these tanks. But then the next is the swirl filter. I'll work on that design a little bit. If you guys have any ideas, let me know. I'm kind of space constrained here, but this is my mechanical filtration chamber. I have the Metalla material right here, which is working out pretty good. I just tossed a bunch of filter floss in there as well. I don't really know if it's going to do a whole lot, because the water is going to take the path of least resistance and just go this way and kind of avoid all of that, but I might get a little bit of biologic filtration out of that at the moment, because right now we don't really have any biologic media to speak of in this system. I do have all of the ceramic rings that were in my Rena XP3 canister filter, and I still do have the sponge filters in operation in two of the 40-gallon breeder tanks. So there is some biofiltration, but not a whole lot. But this barrel is going to be for that bio media. I haven't purchased it yet. I am going to get K1 called this. I don't know how much I'm going to get yet. It's kind of expensive stuff, so I haven't pulled the trigger and made a purchase yet. But I am going to be putting K1 Caldness in this barrel. Hopefully it will fill most of that barrel. I've got to get a very heavy aeration going in this barrel as well to keep that in suspension. But that's kind of the plan. And if you've noticed, what I'm kind of focusing on here in this frame is the drip line. And that drip line is actually going up here over along the wall. You'll notice I'm using the little staples to keep those in, that in place. And if we travel all the way over here, we'll get to our three-stage carbon filter. Carbon drip 40 from the filter guys. It's working really well. As you might recall, I had this set up temporarily in the apartment fish room before that got torn down and before I moved. And I'm happy to say it's now back in operation here in the basement fish room in the house. And basically what we have is a cold water line here, right, which is going to the washing machine, which is kind of boring. But the cold water line splits off here. We get to a quick connect valve, right, and that feeds into another shutoff valve, but then into the three-stage carbon filter, which goes through a 40-gallon per day drip emitter, and then up into my sump. And if we come back over here, you'll notice that the water dripping into here is dripping at the same rate as the water dripping into here. And this is my wastewater barrel. So essentially what's happening is 40 gallons per day is dripping into here, right? The pump is pumping that water back up into the system and circulating that new water. And then 40 gallons per day of aquarium water, which is a mix of the old water plus the new water, is exiting into my wastewater barrel. And when that gets up to about 15 gallons or so, that sump is going to kick on, and about twice a day that water is going to be pumped out through the drain line over there. Pretty exciting, right? Except if I ever go away say, on vacation for a week and the power goes out down here, this pump won't turn on because you need electricity, right? However, this drip line will continue to drip because of the water pressure inside the house. You don't need electricity to continue to get that drip of water. And that becomes a problem because if that continues to drip,
well, this has no way to empty out over time. We could have a water event down here in the basement. And so I hope you will stay tuned for a future DIY Wednesday project where I will show you how to construct a float activated solenoid system which will shut off this water drip in the event that I lose power or the water level in this barrel gets dangerously high. So that'll be exciting. Also, in that same series coming up, I'm going to be constructing a water alarm in the event that this barrel gets too high, dangerously high, of water. And that's actually going to use a alarm and a strobe light combination, typically used for, like, you know, doors that shouldn't be opened or things like that. And what's going to be kind of running both of those things are these tiny little float switches that I got off of the Gemco website. You'll notice this one has a red wire, and the NO at the end stands for normally open. I'll get into this in more detail in later videos, but normally open means that while the water level is low, there's no current, there's no connection, okay? Which means if I hook this up to an alarm, the alarm will only go off when that float rises and it connects that circuit. Alternatively, these are normally closed, and what that means is they will be on unless the water level rises, and then they turn off. So in that way, if the water level gets too high, I can cut the current going through this line and I can connect that to a solenoid switch or valve, which will shut this drip line off.
Pretty exciting stuff. Very basic when it comes to plumbing and electronics. Not very expensive either. And I'm looking forward to making those videos because I think it's going to be the first semi-high-tech element in this otherwise pretty low-tech fish room. And, you know, the sky's the limit from there. The next project is I need to upgrade this lighting. I'm going to be making some DIY LED light strips and replacing those. I'll probably be going the long way here with those light strips instead of kind of cheating and getting two tanks worth of illumination out of one old light fixture. But all of that is to come, guys. I have taps, I have airline, I have a tap and airline valves. I'm going to be doing a whole air system. I need to get a an air pump before I attempt that, but I'll be putting in some PVC airlines and putting in a whole air system to power all of these tanks. And as I've said in the past, I still need to purchase four more tanks, drill those, and get those set up. But the name of the game right here is just kind of take it slow. Obviously, this hobby gets expensive, especially with the more aquariums you have in place. And I'm just kind of taking it one step at a time, making one smart purchase after another in order to get this system fully set up and running. But as you can see, we have small successes already. We have some Pleco fry chowing down, and Daddy Pleco as well. Plenty of endlers, plenty of angelfish, guppies, and turtles, and everything else to come. And I'm really looking forward to it. But
that's the update for today, guys. Hope you enjoyed.
Sorry it was a long video, but I hope it was helpful. All right, guys. See you later.